Let me welcome you once more to our sermon this morning. We are glad that you are always on the alert, and the Lord has been using you even to convey a lot to many people regarding worship. Our sermon today is taken from Exodus chapter 25. We will read verse 1 to verse 9. And let me begin by opening with a word of prayer. Father and our Lord, we want to thank you for the gift of life that you've given to us, and also for the gift of broad daylight that we can enjoy. We want to thank you because, God, you've given us freedom of worship in this country so that we can tabernacle together with you as we continue proclaiming good news to many people and reaffirming to others the value of their faith and building others with the word of God. We want to invite you in our midst as we start, that God, you may superintend everything that we are going to do today. And after all is said and done, Lord, glorify yourself through everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's read from Exodus chapter 25 from verse 1 to 9. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering from each man whose heart prompts him to give. These are the offerings you are to receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and fine linen, goat hair, ram skins, dyed red, and hides of sea cows, acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the fragrant incense, and onyx stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and breastplate. Then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you." Our topic today is on the meaning of offertories. Meaning of offertories. What does it mean when we give tithes, when we give all forms of offerings, when we give thanksgiving, and when we give even support towards ministers and support towards the work of the Lord? First of all, let's understand that giving is actually a relational decision. In the process of making our giving decisions, we really establish our agreement with God about our stewardship. As we continually decide to give, we continually affirm how much we value our relationship to God as his children. In the book, or in the epistle of 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, it says, "Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Here, giving is a voluntary exercise. You are not supposed to be compelled or forced by anybody to give. It is something that you give willfully. It's a choice that you have to make through your willpower. The reason why we give offerings first is to show our obedience to God. For God himself commands his people to give to him. Jesus teaches through Apostle Paul that it is more blessed to give than to receive in Acts chapter 20 verse 35. And also, he also tells us that God also loves a cheerful giver, according to what we've read above there from 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 7. Let us understand as believers that there are different types of giving that the Bible actually gives to us. For instance, let me talk about two of them that we practice on a daily basis, and that these are tithes and offerings. Tithes differ from offerings in the following manner, according to the teaching of the scripture. Tithing is commanded and has a set required amount of how much one should give. I repeat that. Tithing is commanded by God and has a set amount or percentage of how much one should give. God only requires 10% of what he has blessed you with or what he has blessed us with. This money belongs to God, or these things that you give as 10% belong to God and should be given to him regularly. That is the practice of tithing. It is 10% that is given to God regularly based on how he has blessed you as an individual. Tithe is more of an act of recognition and obedience. Tithe is more of an act of recognition and obedience. It is also a way of giving thanks for all the blessings you are receiving from God. It is an act of thanks or giving thanks for all of the blessings that you are receiving from God. Tithing is meant to honor and acknowledge that God is your provider. On this note, it is important for believers to reckon that all our income comes from God. So by giving 10% back to him, you allow God to continue to shower you with his blessings on a daily basis. On the other hand, what do we mean by offerings? Offerings are more of a free will exercise. Offerings are more of a free will exercise. They are completely voluntary. You are not forced to give offerings. As an individual, you choose willfully how much you are going to give to your God as a mark of service to his kingdom. The only distinction with free will offerings is that it was made in a place of God's choosing, not in a place previously used. This could be given any time. So it was made when God demanded it. It was made in a place of his choosing, not a place where people previously used as a worship center. And this is said to be given any time. You are not conditioned to give regularly. This is given when you choose to give to God, and it is through your willpower, and you give it freely. When we look at Exodus chapter 25, verse 1 and 2, God spoke to Moses and said, "Go to the children of Israel and ask them to collect or give offerings for me. Get offerings from the people who have a willing heart." In other words, you are not forced. Offering is from a willing heart, that you must have a willing heart before you give your offerings. Giving offerings is an act of a Christian towards his God. Though it is a free will offering, God does not accept it from anyone. God has had specified to Moses the people who should be involved in giving to him. It was not to be given by everyone. And therefore, he sent Moses to call the Israelites and tell them that they should give him offerings. And specifically, it was not everybody. It was the one who has a willing heart. That is what Moses was directed by God to go and do. So in this case of Moses here, The message was specific. God specifically referred to the Israelites, not Philistines, nor Jebusites or Midianites who were living among them. He was specific to the chosen nation of Israel. They were the ones to give offerings to him. And at the same time, among the nation of Israel, those who had a willing heart were the ones that Moses was directed to go and tell them to give. So Moses was not to coerce anybody or to compel anybody to give. It was a willing heart that was being tested by God. Today, as we live and worship God, God expects us to offer for him. He expects offerings from believers. Who are believers? Those who have been saved through faith in Jesus Christ are the people who are commanded to give to God. Today, God expects offering from this group of people who know who God is to them, who know Jesus Christ in a personal way. Not those who have not given their, not those who have not given their faith to God. We cannot go around collecting offerings from anybody. God is specific. When we are worshiping him and giving as a mark of worship to God, basically, we have to be reminded that we should have a personal relationship with God himself. And since God has chosen Israel as the nation that you should set example for the other nations, God directed Moses to go to Israelites. In fact, he spoke to Moses and he was specific on the kind of people who are going to give to him. What Moses has received from God is a command of God to his people, the chosen one, the Israelites. God directed the offerings to be collected from his own people, not strangers. And therefore, when we choose to give to God, those who know Christ are the ones who are actually commanded or expected to offer to him. Basically, when we talk about giving to God, offering to God, it is not everyone. It is those who know that they have established a personal relationship with God, and God is inquiring of them to give towards his ministries in the church. God is always specific to those he demands offering from. He directed Abraham to offer to him. He did not go to many people who are living in the Ur of Chaldeans, but he went to Abraham. And the way he told Moses, tell the Israelites to offer to me, he went also to Abraham. And what did he tell him? Abraham was told by God, go and offer your son to me. He wanted him to sacrifice his son. And he almost did it before God intervened in the process. He tested the faith of Abraham through offering. And he had required him to offer his son. And here the faith of Israelites is being tested also. Moses is told, go tell those who have a willing heart to offer to me. And so, although there were many Israelites, a few who had willing hearts offered to God. During the time of Moses, the Israelites were charged with the duty of offering to their God, because God wanted to erect a tabernacle, and he slotted and explained to Moses the kinds of things that should be brought to him. And they are narrated from verse 4 all the way to verse 8. You see God directing people on what they are going to give so that they may build a place where they will be congregating to meet with their Lord. So, when we talk of offering, it is a free will exercise and is given by God's chosen men and God-fearing people. A team that God has saved and are under his sovereignty and guidance. And if today as believers, we believe we are under God's sovereignty and under his guidance and protection, this offering is required of us. So, the offering is supposed to be taken from the people who are willing us to give to God. You cannot take offerings from those who are not willing to give to God. You take from those who are cheerful and ready to give to God. Sometimes we make mistakes by waiting upon people who are not willing to give towards the Lord's ministry. We force people, We call them to stand, to come and give. But here, God commanded the Israelites, those who are willing, and those who are giving cheerfully and give with a cheerful heart, those who give happily, those are the people that God expects to give towards his ministry. So giving was limited to those who had willing hearts, not from every living Israelite. Israelites were human as we are today, and some of them felt that they should not give. And therefore, that's why Moses was given that condition. It is those who are willing to give. Those are the people that you should accept offerings from. There are four types of givers. There are those who give to God with a willing heart, joyfully and happy. There are those who give because others are giving. It becomes a duty, a practice. Because the others are doing it, let me do it. There are those who are coerced in order to give, who are forced to give. Somebody must scream to them, must tell them that they should give. And then fourthly, there are those who give as a show off, to be seen by others. And we can see these among the Pharisees. We can see all these groups of categories among the religious leaders during the time of Jesus. The scripture is very clear that those who have a willing heart should give to the Lord. You should not be coerced. You should not follow other people. Or you should not actually give as a show off. You should give with a willing heart. God received offerings from a willing and joyful people. And that's what happened as they were building this tabernacle. Those who came to give were cheerful and they gave willingly. One whose heart is free to serve God is the one who gives willfully. But not one who gives as though it's a duty and he has to fulfill it. When you take it as a duty, but not as a mark of showing obedience to God, it is no longer worship through giving. It is something else. And therefore, your willpower must be tuned, must be in tune with God, so that as God commands you to act, you act following what he has commanded. And therefore, receiving offerings for the Lord is for those who are ready and are willing to give. It is a willful act. You make a choice to give towards God. Secondly, you must be happy and willing when you are called upon to offer to God. There are many people who actually are not happy when it comes to time to give towards the Lord. And therefore, my challenge this morning is to everybody who is giving towards God. The Bible says that you should not come before the Lord empty-handed or with empty hands. Come to the Lord having chosen what you are going to give. Don't just wake up and decide what you are going to give right there and on. You must pray over it and bring it to the Lord. Abel and Cain went to give to the Lord. It was willful giving. Abel gave willfully and Cain gave what he decided he wanted to give. And Cain took it as a competition because he was looking at favor from God. God accepted Abel's offering and he rejected Cain's. Why? Because Abel gave with a willing heart. Abel gave willfully. He had chosen what to offer to God. Choose what to offer to God in advance. Don't just go to offer because you want to go and show God that you are participating in the act of offering. Cain was just participating. His heart was not in it. Everything he did was just to show that he identified with what God demanded, but his heart and his mind was not there. In Exodus chapter 35 verse 4, where we read, and Moses spoke, this is the thing which the Lord commanded, saying, verse 5, take ye from among you an offering unto the Lord, whosoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it, an offering of the Lord, gold and silver and brass. And you can read all the way to verse 10. You see God demanding things that men and women who actually were willing to give to God should bring forth. They should begin with the valuables. Gold, silver, and brass. Those were valuable things that were actually required by the Israelites. And they needed them. But God told them that start giving your gold, your silver, and brass. And then he went to blue, the purple, the scarlet, fine linen, and goat's hair. A ram skin dyed red, and the badger skins and shittim wood, and oil for the light, and spices for anointing oil, and for the sweet incense, and onyx stones, and stones to be set for the ephod, and for the breastplate. And every wise hearted among you shall come and make all that the Lord has commanded. And I like verse 10. It says, and every wise hearted among you shall come and make all that the Lord hath commanded. So not only are you supposed to be willing, but you are supposed to use your wisdom and come before the Lord and serve him with what God has commanded you to do. You should not be coerced. It's a choice. And he says, every wise hearted among you shall come and make all that the Lord God has commanded. God repeats here, at the same time, Moses was commanded in verse 2, God tell the Israelites, whoever is willing to offer to me. Verse 5, he goes before the Israelites to tell them the oracles of God. And he tells them that God has sent me to you. And he has told me that those with willing hearts, those who are wise-hearted, should go before the Lord and actually hearken to his command and give as God has commanded. And therefore, God repeats that whoever has a willing heart, he should give to the Lord. Not whoever has to be coerced, but whoever has a willing heart. How can you describe a willing heart? It is what you choose to give God from within your own heart willfully. You give it as you have chosen. So a willing heart is conditioned on you. What you choose to give God from your own heart willfully, you end up giving it to him. You don't choose abruptly what you're going to give to God. You must choose. Every time you go before the Lord, go to him with an offering that you have willed to give to the Lord. With the tithe, that is specific that you are supposed to give because God has blessed you. In Exodus chapter 35, verse 21, it says, up to 29, let me read that. And they came, these are Israelites now, after listening to Moses, look at what they are going to do. And they came, everyone whose heart stirred him up, and everyone whom his spirit made willing. And they brought the Lord's offering to the work of the tabernacle of the congregation and of all his service and for the holy garments. And they came, both men and women, as many as were willing-hearted, and brought bracelets and earrings and rings and tablets, all jewels of gold, and every man that offered an offering of gold unto the Lord. And every man with whom was found blue and purple and scarlet, and fine linen, and goat's hair, and red skins of rams, and badger skins brought them. Everyone who did offer an offering of silver and brass brought the Lord's offering. And every man with whom was found shittim wood for any work of the service brought it. And all the women who were wise-hearted did spin with their hands, and brought that which they had spun, both of blue and purple, and of scarlet, and of fine linen. And all the women whose hearts stirred them up in wisdom span God's hair. And the rulers brought onyx stones and stones to be set for the ephod and for the breastplate, and spice and oil for the light and for the anointing oil and for the sweet incense. Verse 29 and the last one. The children of Israel brought a willing offering unto the Lord, every man and woman whose heart made them willing to bring for all manner of work, such the Lord had commanded to be made by the hand of Moses. Basically, here we see those who are willing, both men and women. Those who are willing sat down and worked on what they wanted to bring to the Lord. They did not just wake up to bring whatever they had. They sat and decided whatever they wanted to bring to the Lord. Members, our believers, I want to challenge you that before you come before the Lord to offer anything, make sure that you have willpower as commanded you and you have decided what you are going to give to the Lord. Don't just come as a person who is aimless, who has no purpose. Give with a purpose and give with a willing heart. He whose heart excited him and was up to the task brought that which he willed to bring to the Lord. And Moses received these things from people who were wise and were willing to give to the Lord. Each was to discern clearly what he was to present before the Lord. You were not forced to give what you did not have. You gave what you had and what you had decided to give to the Lord. So they began by giving their valuables, and then everything else that was required, people set out to go and give to the Lord and even take time to prepare what they are going to give to the Lord. Women had to sit down and actually work on the essentials that they were to bring before the Lord. Both men and women who were willing to give, gave to the Lord. Church, today, we must be willing to serve God willfully. We must not be coerced to give towards the ministry of the Lord, to give tithes, to give offerings, to give thanksgiving, to give first fruits. These are things that God demands of you. But God is not forcing you to give to him. It is you who chooses whether you're going to give to the Lord or not. So you can have thanksgiving. You can even give towards the support for your ministers. You can give your tithes, your first fruits, and everything that God has commanded in the scriptures. You give freely and you give willfully. You do not take offerings from unwilling people. And I do believe nowadays it is as though the church has gotten to another extent whereby they have to force people to give. Basically, we should not go there, because God does not want people to be forced to give. He says he loves a cheerful giver, a person who decides what to give to him and gives to him happily. That's what God loves. Let the willing people serve the Lord. Those who are willing to serve the Lord, let them serve the Lord. There are those who come to church and say that I will never give because of so and so. You do not give because so and so has asked you to give. You give because God has asked you for it in order to support his ministry. If you stop giving because people are, you think they are consuming whatever there is being given, you're making a big mistake. You give because God has commanded his people to give. And you give willfully, not under any, you are not compelled. Do not come before the Lord empty-handed. Always remember, as you come before the Lord to worship him, always come with something. In Hebrews chapter 14, verse 4, Abel and Cain are named there. Abel was upright. He gave a perfect offering. God approved it and celebrated it. In James chapter 2, verse 21 to 23, Abraham offered his son, and it was counted to him as righteous, and was counted as a friend of God. God approved the offering of Abraham, and in fact, as a result of his obedience to him, Abraham became a friend of God, because he offered what God had asked for him. God intercepted. He did not allow the son to be offered, but that act itself gave Abraham another distinction of being a friend of God. He is the father of the righteous, but he's also described as a friend of God. Brothers and sisters, if you want to be a friend of God, you want to be righteous, give as God commands you to give, and don't give under any impression that you are being forced. Give willfully, use your wisdom as you give, and give what God has directed you to give. God's are directed, we offer to him with a willing heart, but not under pressure from anybody. Having said that, and having gone through the background of this, what do we learn from giving our offertories? One, the meaning of giving offertories is that actually giving draws men closer to God. Giving draws men closer to God. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, it says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." When you give out of love and compassion, your heart is next to God. When you give your money, your time, your effort, your thinking, your life to the service of God's kingdom, basically, you continue drawing closer to God. And this act of giving our time and giving our resources to the service of the kingdom, so Abel blessed, so Abraham became the friend of God, and so Abraham became a man who was righteous. And this is what drew the children of Israel to God, because after giving, they build a place of meeting with God, and they continued to draw closer to God. And therefore, giving draws people, believers, closer to God. Secondly, the other thing that we learn from this is that giving strengthens one's faith. Giving strengthens one's faith. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 9, it says, "Trust the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you produce." Basically, as you give, your faith is strengthened. This kind of giving requires a lot of faith. Every giving requires a lot of faith. You look at that widow who gave to the servant of God in Zarephath, cooked for Elijah. When Elijah actually ate, the woman was blessed. It requires a lot of faith. You give even your last penny. Remember the woman who put what she had in that chest. And Jesus said, actually she is more blessed, and she gave a lot more than those who gave throughout of their riches. Basically, giving has to strengthen your faith. You have to believe that God is going to do something when you give to him. And therefore, the more you give, the more stronger your faith grows and becomes. You cannot outgive God. When you give to God, the more you give, the more he provides you with the ability to give. Luke chapter 6, verse 38 says, "Give, and it will be given to you. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." It is in giving our money and our resources and our material possession that God literally tells us that, "I dare you, test me. Test me with your things." God dares us so that he can show us that he can give back. He says in Luke, "Give and it will be given back to you." So when you give God, he takes pleasure in adding more blessings your way, bringing blessings your way. But if you don't give to him, you are not, he's daring you, but you are not responding to what he's daring you to do. Thirdly, giving is an investment for eternity. Giving is an investment for eternity. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 18 to 19, when we read in the Living Bible, it says, "Give happily to those in need, and always be ready to share whatever God has given you. By doing this, you will be storing real treasure for yourself in heaven." By doing this, you will be storing real treasure for yourselves in heaven. It is the only safe investment for eternity. So, if you want to store your treasure in heaven, offer to God, give to God, because giving is an investment for eternity. Lastly, number four, what do we learn? Giving is an indication of one's spiritual maturity. Giving is an indication of one's spiritual maturity. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7, it says, "But just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, see that you also excel in this grace of giving." In other words, if you mature in your faith, if you mature in your speech, if you mature in your knowledge, if you mature in complete earnestness, the word of God is telling you that also seek to excel or seek to mature in the grace of giving. It shows that you've grown spiritually. It shows us that you can trust God through faith for God to undertake for you. Giving is an indication of one's spiritual maturity. And the more you mature, the more you learn God gives back. The more you mature, the more you give, even when you think you are giving your last bit, like that woman. Giving is more about a person's spiritual maturity than it is about the actual giving. When you are giving, giving is more about your maturity than it is about the actual giving of the resources that you have. We tend to hold on to our money and to our wealth as a form of our security. We cannot trust God and trust in our money at the same time. We have to let go and allow God to use it to our own benefit. Giving is a discipline of learning to trust in God. And it reminds us of the truth of our spiritual maturity. Let me remind you about that. Giving is a discipline of learning to trust in God for his provision. And it reminds you of the truth of our spiritual maturity. When you give, it's a sign that you are maturing in your faith. But if you start debating whether to give to God, it means that you are still trying to ask whether what you give to God is going to give back. Whether the resources you give to God, whether they are in safe hands. God tells us that he loves a cheerful giver. God tells the Israelites that whoever is willing should actually offer to him, but not anybody who is coerced. He also tells us that use your wisdom as you give. That is God himself. And the women, where we read of Israelites, use their wisdom, the wisdom as they gave to the Lord. And therefore, if you forgot everything else, remember this. We are talking about the meaning of giving, offertories. When we give, giving draws me and you closer to God. Giving strengthens your faith. Giving is an investment in eternity. And giving is an indication of your spiritual maturity. May the Lord God help you as you enter into this worship of giving. And know that giving is a willful act, something you will to do. Giving has to use a lot of wisdom. Giving is not forced. Giving, the Lord says, he loves a cheerful giver. Brothers and sisters, if you choose to serve God through giving, offertories, thanksgiving, tithe, follow the command of God, because it is God's command, and giving has to be accompanied by obedience to God's command. May the Lord God bless you and keep you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for reminding us that as we serve and commune with you, we want to pray that God, our giving will be an indication of our spiritual maturity. It will be an investment in eternity. It will strengthen our faith. And finally, it will draw us closer to you. God, may we pray that as we give, we'll give having discerned what you have to bring to you. You tell us not to come before you empty-handed. And Lord, we want to pray that we will continue serving you with a lot of dedication and commitment in this grace of giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
He will bid us welcome. We shall come rejoicing, bringing you the sheep.